Good evening. I'm Ruth Weinstein, and together with Jeffrey Lewis, we are co-chairs of the Jonathan Sayman Hot Buttons Cool Conversations program. Tonight, we present a program entitled How Judges Judge. While the judicial selection process varies from state to state and nation to nation, the ideals we look for in the people who dispense justice are universal. Integrity, both personally and professionally, a thorough knowledge and understanding of applicable law, and the ability to approach and decide issues with independence, intelligence, fairness, and compassion. These attributes allow a judge to objectively and impartially interpret and apply the law based upon the evidence and arguments presented. Tonight we ask the following intriguing question. While striving for objectivity and impartiality, how does a judge manage to hold personal beliefs and views at bay while engaging in decision-making processes that will affect the ways our society functions? Can any human being be reasonably expected to do this? To explore this, we are honored to have with us former Judge Nancy Gertner and Justice Salim Joubran.
Our moderator tonight is Fred Lawrence. Professor Lawrence received his law degree from the Yale Law School and began an illustrious career as a legal scholar and professor concentrating on civil rights, criminal law, and civil procedure.
This is a wonderful opportunity for all of us, I think, to learn from two distinguished jurists about how judges judge, and my guess is as the evening unfolds, we'll learn a lot more from both of them about a range of issues of identity and how that relates to lawmaking and law interpretation. I'll just add one note of personal privilege, which is that excluded from Judge Gertner's biography is the fact, you know what I'm going to say, Nancy holds a honorary doctorate from Brandeis University that I was privileged to bestow upon her, which means that she is my alumna, which means I'm entitled between now and the end of June to ask her for a contribution.
I'm going to leave.
Presidents are never off duty. So let me begin in the following way. Chief Justice Roberts, in his confirmation hearings, famously used the analogy of the judge as an umpire, just calling balls and strikes. It probably was a more complicated analogy than he intended it to be. Anyone in the audience who's played any baseball or even watched any baseball knows there are umpires who've got big strike zones and small strike zones, and sometimes the strike zones seem to get larger or smaller depending on who the batter is or whether the Yankees are in town. So the fact is maybe he, even the analogy gave away the game to a certain extent. But what he was trying to say is that the judge, like the umpire, is extrinsic from the game. There's a game that has rules and that the judge stands outside of it and just applies those rules. But let me frame the question ever so slightly differently and then ask each of you to situate yourself on a continuum. What we often do with first-year law students is teach them the art of establishing the two points on a spectrum, neither of which could really be correct. They're both a little intended to be a little extreme. And then where do we find ourselves in the middle? So let's not do umpires in baseball games. Let's say a judge as one cartoon version. A judge could just be someone with a scale who's simply measuring, and that the law is a fixed method, and the judge takes the facts or instructs the jury to find the facts and just applies that fixed law. Now, that's obviously a cartoon version of what a judge could do, but that would be sort of the extreme of the objective judge. Now, all the way on the other side, also a cartoon, would be the judge really as a political figure, who says, my job is to do justice, and whatever the law actually says is not my issue. I'm going to make the law in a particular case because my job is to see that justice is done and get the right conclusion. I think also an extreme case. But I think that helps set us out the poles of what a judge could do. In one case, it's all about what the judge thinks. And in the other case, it's nothing to do with what the judge thinks. Nancy, where are you on that spectrum, and how do you think
well,
about
it? Well, I'm off the spectrum now,
says?
So, no. Where was I?
Where were you?
Was I?
And then I will turn to Justice Joubran for the same question.
It's very hard to situate. The classic way of answering the question is, of course, not to answer the question. I understood from the beginning that no one could be the objective balls and strikes person. it was impossible to be that person. Choice and judgment were inherent in everything you did as a judge, from what you decided to be the most important thing on your docket, what you decided to give time, even administrative, even ministerial decisions were the product of choice and ranking and hierarchy, where your experience of what you thought was important came into that. I, for example, would spend hours in the afternoon after 3 o'clock sentencing, because I was actually, that was the time that I wanted to spend, you know, to focus on it, and I knew that I would be able to give it the time. Other judges would have, you know, 15, 20 minute sentencing proceedings. So choice and judgment is, it's not automatic. It comes into everything you do. And then likewise, in a common law country, meaning a country like the United States, like Israel, choice and judgment, the law doesn't enforce itself. The language of the Constitution is famously vague. The words don't interpret themselves no matter what Justice Scalia says. There's judgment that goes into analyses about proportionality, judgment that goes into what the reasonable man is, what's reasonable in the law, in the civil law, in the criminal law. All of these are judgments that you have to evaluate. Even as a trial judge, some of our discussion will be, I was a trial judge, not a Supreme Court judge. I was supposed to make judgments about credibility, and who I was as a human being obviously played into that. Things that I might find credible, let me give you a classic example. In the midst of the battles around Ferguson and Baltimore, the police abuse scandals, I had been a civil rights lawyer. It was not a surprise to me that police officers sometimes didn't tell the truth. And so when a police officer was on the stand, that was not something that was, I didn't assume he was lying. I didn't assume he was telling the truth. I could envision that he was coloring what he was saying. Some of my colleagues who had no experience ever as a criminal defense lawyer or no experience outside of big firm practice couldn't imagine that a police officer would lie. So experience and judgment and weighing play into ministerial decisions, procedural decisions, play into the content, the substance, the doctrine, play into credibility decisions as well. So that puts me, I suppose, away from the robotic concept of the judge. But at the same token, I was constantly warring in my heart and in my opinions with what my past had been. In other words, I was constantly weighing and measuring, am I seeing this witness for whom he, for who he is, or am I looking at this through the prism of my experience too much? In one sense, that balance was easier for me because I knew exactly what I believed in. I did not pretend, as Justice Roberts and Justice Thomas pretend, to have no opinions prior to becoming a judge. I knew exactly what I believed in. And so I was constantly balancing, or trying to understand, balancing isn't the right word, where my opinions, how my opinions played into my judging. It was an explicit battle. It was difficult, but I was doing that all the time. And there were surely times, which I'm writing about now, where I could not remotely do what I thought was fair. I couldn't do what I thought was fair because the law had changed so dramatically. So the answer is I'm in the middle. I know you're surprised at that answer, but there isn't a judge in the galaxy who would give you a different answer.
Well, we're going to find out. And I'm going to come back to you shortly to give us a couple of examples, or at least one good example, where you couldn't do something
that I wanted to do.
Okay. So where on this spectrum would you situate yourself? Again, neither endpoint is realistic, but it is meant to be sort of a thought experiment to describe the push and pull between being the neutral judge on the one hand or the mere politician on the other, and a judge can't be either.
Let me at the beginning thank the Greater Boston JCC for inviting me to this great event. Thank you very much. And I am so glad that you are all here. There is a story about President Ronald Reagan. He was once invited to visit the Alcatraz prison. And when he finished the visit, one of his advisors asked him to say something to the prisoners. Well, he said, what I can tell, they are prisoners. At the end of the day, he agreed and they said, dear friends, I am so glad that you are all here. And I am glad that you are here. Not from the reasons of President Reagan, but because I am glad that you are here.
Oh, that's wonderful.
The analogy is not obvious, by the way.
Well, I agree with Judge Gertner about the fact that a judge should be objective. But at the same time, I think sometimes it's not 100% objective, because a judge comes to the bench with his personal background. And sometimes this gives him the chance to interpret the law in other way that was usual way of interpreting the law. The law says something, but at the same time, because the judge came from his personal background, gives him the opportunity to express his opinions in other way that it was used to be interpreted until that time by other judges. And the background is very important, and to know the judge, you should know his background, because I give an example for myself. I belong to the Arab minority in Israel, but at the same time, I grew up in the mixed city where Jews and Arabs used to live together. And I was graduated from a Christian school, belongs to the Franciscan order, and we studied Arabic and Hebrew and English. We studied the New Testament and the Old Testament at the same time. Then I have had the opportunity to know many things about the Jewish heritage, the Jewish religion, Jewish customs, and traditions. At the same time, I, of course, know my heritage and traditions. And I brought all this with me to the bench while dealing with cases where the parties are Arabs or, at the same time, parties are Jews. And my perspective is to try to solve the cases before me in a way that I know the origin of the dispute, because I know things what happened in the Jewish community. And sometimes when I was a magistrate court 30 years ago, I have many cases concerning the disputes in the Bet Knesset between many. There are sometimes two parties in the Bet Knesset, and I was the Arab judge to solve those cases. And I used my knowledge in the Jewish law and the Jewish tradition to bring them for a compromise. And then in many cases, they asked, Judge Joubran will take this case and this, because he knows many things about the Jewish religion. You know, my background gave me the chance to try to find better solutions to the cases brought before me as a judge in the court.
You have undoubtedly heard yourself introduced countless times as a Arab member of the Israeli Supreme Court. But other than as a biographical fact, what does that mean? We wouldn't say the other judges are Jewish justices of the court, but of course they are. So how do you think that affects you, and to what extent is that a role that you feel you have to play as you make decisions, or to what extent is that a role that you check at the door when you make decisions?
Well, actually, my status as an Arab judge in the Israeli Supreme Court is very special. It used to be a very special status, but at the same time, it's a normal status, because I am member of this high court in Israel. I am very proud to be a member of this court, of course, and I am representing all the people of Israel on the court, not only the Arab sector. Well, when I was appointed to this capacity, it was this event was a historical event, because it's the first time that an Arab judge was appointed to this capacity. And this appointment was accepted very well by all parts of the population, Jews, Arabs, Muslims, and Christians. I belong to the Christian community, but I believe that I am sitting on the bench and representing all the people of the state of Israel, nevertheless, regardless of their religion or nationality. And I think my role is a very important one by knowing the problems in the Arab minority and the needs of this minority gives me the opportunity to express what they feel in my opinions. And I think it is a good way to do that. At the same time, because I know many things about the Jewish law, the Jewish religion, I have the opportunity also to give my opinions in Jewish issues. For example, we have had several years ago the matter of separation between the ultra-Orthodox Jews and the woman in the public transportation in Jerusalem. It was a great issue, and I was a member of the panel at that time and gave my opinion. And of course, I said that it is illegal, this, and we unanimously said that this situation is illegal and it is respected until today. Then I don't think that I was an outsider in this case because I knew many things about the Jewish law. I studied the Jewish law at the university, at the law school. And when I was a student, I lived with two yeshiva students in Jerusalem. They were my neighbors. I taught them Arabic and they taught me Talmud and Pirkei Avot, Mishnah, Gemara, Baba Batra, Baba Metzia, all this, I didn't know that. And until today, I think that I of course, I don't know all the Jewish law, but I have experience. I know many of the Jewish law and the Jewish traditions, and I am satisfied when I am giving my opinions in these cases. And sometimes I also quote from the holy books. You know, we should, as judges, give our rulings according to the facts before us, and according to the Israeli law, which is a secular law. But at the same time, in order to strengthen my opinion sometimes, I go back to the holy books and I quote from the Torah, from the New Testament, and from the Quran. And it's a beautiful thing that somebody says, how you can quote from the Tanakh? It's not your book. First of all, it's my book. But at the same time, it's good to go back to the origin of the religions in order to strengthen my opinion. Usually we have in our court three Jewish religious judges. Of course, they very often use quotations from the Tanakh, but I myself and other judges were secular, we also quote from the holy books, and it is good, I think, to go back to the holy books. I believe, of course, in those books, and it's a good idea, and this, I take it being a living in a mixed city where my neighbors were Jews, and I remember that we have had a neighbor for 40 years, a Jewish family from Moroccan origin. And we until now, very good relations with their children until now. And I used to be a goy of Shabbat that day for them. And every Pesach, at the end of Pesach, we brought them the pita bread and, you know, and the yogurt, you know. And it's very, until now, we are doing that with other Jewish families, friends. And we used to be invited to them for Leila Seder and to read the Agadah of Pesach, you know. And we used to invite them in Christmas to see the Christmas tree and to eat the nice Swiss chocolates and to the presence of Papa Noel and Santa Claus and Santa Claus. This is the way that give me the opportunity to be involved in the Arab sector and the Jewish sector and influenced my opinions in the court until today.
See, maybe I would have been reversed less if I had quoted the Bible more. I wish I had seen and heard this insight. Damn.
Now you have a chance as a retired judge to make it in your books.
One of my mentors in law school, the late Charles Black, used to say, when being radical, use as much Latin as possible. which the Israeli Supreme Court in your opinions included, has been very effective at finding definitions of dignity, which is in fact a very progressive and judicially robust approach, but grounding it in Tanakh. Nancy, let me come back to the question I'd promised I was going to ask you. So could you give us an example of one where, and I actually am going to pose a similar question in a slightly more pointed way in a moment, Justice Joubran. But can you give us an example where you felt you couldn't do what you wanted to, or you couldn't do, I think the word you used was fair. You couldn't do what was fair.
I couldn't do what was fair, right. Well, let me give you two examples. One where I could and where my experience played into my being able to do what I thought was right, and other instances when I couldn't. One of the cases, right before I left the bench, I had a case of a woman who claimed that she was a prisoner, and she claimed that that the guard had had sex with her. And she claimed it was a violation of the Eighth Amendment because even though there was no physical force involved, she was clearly under his supervision. She had filed the lawsuit in court. My law clerks came to me and said, "Judge, you have to dismiss the case." "What do you mean I have to dismiss the case?" She said, "Well, there were 20 cases of other courts that said that unless there's violence here, there's no violation of cruel and unusual punishment." I knew women prisoners. I knew the issue. I said that is absurd. This is an issue that a jury should decide. I shouldn't say, at the start, there isn't a conceivable Eighth Amendment violation. I should let a jury decide. And so that was a case in which I let the case proceed, went to a jury, and ultimately she got a verdict. But I approached that flat page of text with my experience. I understood that I had the room I had to address it in was a jury trial. So that was one situation where I could accomplish what I thought was fair. And there it was only the fairness of having a jury hear the case. But if I hadn't had the experience I had, it would have been so easy to just dash this off and say, "Oh, I have to dismiss the case." The cases where I could not do what was fair were over 100% the criminal cases. And I'm writing about that. I will say I sentenced 534 people, overwhelmingly men, overwhelmingly African American, to sentences which I can say without equivocation were disproportionate to what they should have gotten. And that was largely because of mandatory minimums and mandatory guidelines. I refused to say, as some judges did, that the guidelines were fair. I would be, every day that I did that, I continued to have a bellyache that I was not going to let go of, because I wanted to make sure that that independent perspective, the independent perspective that said this man does not deserve 10 years, lived in me. I couldn't do anything about it. But I certainly, that's what I meant by the tension. I was not, I knew who I was, I knew what I thought was fair, and I knew what I had to do, but I was not going to pretend that it was right. And I'm not, what didn't pretend then, and I'm not going to pretend now that it was right. So those are the criminal cases were absolutely the worst in that regard.
You said that among the things that you get to do and maybe feel obliged to do is to represent the views or the beliefs or the challenges, the problems of members of the Arab minority in Israel in your jurisprudence, in your writing. So what happens if the law runs in the other direction? Can you give us an example? And let me set the ground rules here for a second. It's much easier with former Judge Gertner to ask questions that can't possibly come before her on the bench unless the president had the good sense to reappoint you in the Senate to confirm
right.
you.
My chances for the Supreme Court are long ago shot, so I can say whatever I want.
Okay. Whereas when we have and I'm not making light of this, when we have a sitting justice in the room, there are things you can say and things you can't say, and we will be solicitous of that. Within that, can you give us an example where what you would have wanted to represent in what you would have written was a place the law could not take you?
Well, I can give an example for a ruling which was given by the court. Then I can talk about it. It's not pending for the court. There was a petition filed to our court by a human rights organization against the law, which was called the Law of Acceptance Committee. In some of the small communal settlements in Israel, the law gives the privilege to a special committee from this settlement to accept people as members of the community or not. And usually some Arab families wanted to join this community, and they didn't pass the acceptance committee. Well, they petitioned to our court. What you asked, what I wanted to do, I didn't succeed. And the ruling was in a majority of 5 judges against 9, against 4. The petition was not accepted because it's 5 against 4. I was in the minority. I wrote the leading opinion of the minority. And I said, this is a kind of discrimination against the Arab citizens. And the whole judges said that discrimination is unlawful. There should be equal rights. But the majority thought that because there was not a specific petition by a specific person brought before the court, the case is not ready yet. Mm. That was the only reason. The old judges said discrimination is unlawful in Israel, the majority and minority. But because there was no specific case with a specific family came to this acceptance committee, petition was dismissed. But at the same time, my opinion was that there will be a chilling effect because many Arab families will not go to this accepting committee because they know that they will not succeed. And at the same time, the court decided not to accept this petition. I wanted, of course, to express my feeling that there should not be discrimination, but the court decided something else. At the same time, I respect, of course, the ruling of this court, and maybe in the future when the court opened the door for couples who will come again before, who will appear before this acceptance committee, and if they fail the exam, then they will have the right to apply again to the court. But this is an example that the law says something, and I wanted to try to do something else, but I didn't succeed. But I'm not sad, and I accept this ruling. We are in a democratic country and democratic court. We have sometimes the majority and minority. This is the situation.
So I think we're just playing far too nicely here. I'm going to have to mess this up just a little bit. So when you talked about being able to cite Tanakh or Christian scripture or the Quran, that's because none of those is technically speaking a legal source within a secular legal system, but they can all be brought as authority. But there is the embedded in Israeli law, the notion of Israel as a Jewish state. So how does that resonate to a non-Jewish member of the court? And I will frame it in the following way. A student of ours at Brandeis, a brilliant young man who was the first non-Christian head of a YMCA, he was the head of the YMCA in Jerusalem until relatively recently, said that it's very hard for him to sing HaTikvah because he said if they'd only change it to Nefesh Yisraeli as opposed to Nefesh Yehudi. He said, how can I sing a song as my national anthem at the spirit or the soul of the Jew when I'm not Jewish? So how does that resonate with a non-Jewish member of the Supreme Court who is interpreting the law of a state that is in fact a Jewish state, proclaims itself to be a Jewish state?
I'm sure that I don't have any problem with that because according to the Israeli law, until the 1980s of the last century, when a judge faced a lacuna in the law, he should go back to the origin of the common law, British common law, because the British mandate was in Palestine at that time since 1918 until 1948. But the legislature in 1980 changed the situation and enacted a law when a judge faces a lacoon, he should go back to the Israeli values and heritage. It's a law today. And for this reason, not because I think I'm an Arab, I should not go back to the Jewish heritage, but the law says that. And I don't think that I have a problem with that, because I know the Jewish law. Not all, but I have many things about the Jewish law. Then I think I don't have any problem while quoting from the Tanakh and from the Talmud, the Mishnah, the Kitab Rashi, and all these together. I have no problem with that. About the question of the Hatikva, I prefer not to respond, because it was an issue 3 years ago when I was at the residence of the State of Israel on the occasion of our President Asher Gruneis. He was appointed the presidency, and I was the only gentleman that I didn't open my mouth, and I didn't sing the Tikva, and the press should put the camera on my mouth, all the TV, and it was a great issue in the country. But at the end of the day, I was backed by the Prime Minister and the President of the state, and the many persons in Israel backed my opinion that I can't sing the Tikva and say the Nefesh Yehudi. Well, this is the problem. Not because I didn't want, but I can't do it because I'm a Jewish, you know. And this was, I think since that time, everything is all right. No TV when I am in many, many occasions, they see me, and the TV reporters laugh and smile with me, no problems. They said that you are right. No, so at the same time, they said that Justice Joubran honored the anthem while standing. Mm-hmm. I didn't sit down. I stood up like all my colleagues. I honored the place. I honored the anthem, but I didn't sing that.
What's the analogous question for me, Fred? This is very interesting.
Well, let's take you back long before you were on the bench to an area that a legal scholar both of us know and I think have fondness for, the late Robert Cover.
Sure.
Wrote about extensively. What anti-slavery judges should have done in the pre-Civil War period, when clearly slavery was legal in the United States, and the conflict, what an anti-slavery, I shouldn't say an anti-slavery judge, a judge who had a personal conviction that slavery was wrong. So let's travel back in time, and you're on the bench in the District of Massachusetts in a fugitive slave case, pre-13th Amendment, where slavery is legal, and where the Fugitive Slave Act is the law of the land. So how much wiggle room is there in that, or is that like the sentencing guidelines and you have no choice?
Well, actually, Robert Cover was a professor at Yale. I read his work before I went on the bench, because what he wrote about was how you dealt with your passion against slavery, and on the one hand, and the law on the other. And what he wrote about, which is very interesting, was what analogous to what I said before. Many times, these anti-slavery judges enforced the Fugitive Slave Act more rigorously than they had to prove their independence, to prove that they were judges. And indeed, imposed a regime that was way more strict than it had to be. So the answer is, I took some comfort in the fact that, first of all, I knew what I believed in. I didn't pretend, as I said, that I had a confirmation conversion. I knew what I believed in. I would try to see if the law could be made consistent with what I thought was fair. But I also recognized, and I was intellectually honest enough to realize, when I could not do that. So carrying that over to the Fugitive Slave Act, I would have said, this is an abomination, this is an anathema, the northern states should not be returning slaves, but there is this law. Is there any room for interpretation of the law that enables a more humane outcome? And if the answer was no, I would understand that I'd have to say no. Then I would write a little note to myself, and then I'd write about it after I left the bench, but that's another discussion. But I would say no.
Another plug for the book. You got a plug for the
book. Soon to be a major motion picture, this book. With respect to criminal materials, criminal cases, when I hit a mandatory minimum, there was nothing I could do. There's nothing I could do. When there were guidelines which you had some wiggle room at, I would see if there was a way to interpret the guidelines that would be consistent with what I thought was fair. But then I also wrote decisions. You have to write decisions as a Supreme Court judge. We were actually encouraged not to write decisions. But I would write, very interesting, district court judges were encouraged not to write decisions at all.
You are lucky.
Yes, well, but I would write because if I couldn't justify what I was doing on the page, I couldn't do it. And it created, to some degree, a rigor that enabled me to say, I think this is unfair, but there is nothing I can do about it. And I could put that on the page. And that satisfies my sense of what would be fair and my sense of what I had to do. But the law does not enforce itself. The numbers of times when, in fact, there was nothing that you could do were very limited. There was always something you could do. Could you do what you actually wanted to do in the absence of any restrictions? No. But there was always something one could do, except for, as I said, some of the extraordinary punishments. Just a silly example. The sentencing regime didn't allow us to look at family circumstances, right? Before the sentencing regime came in, you could look at whether someone had children or whether or not they were caring for an elderly parent. When the United States passed the Sentencing Reform Act, you could somehow, the only times you could look at family circumstances or if they were extraordinary. And it made no sense. And I wrote a series of decisions about how that made no sense in the light of the statute. It made no sense that we couldn't look at, was she the sole support of her family? Was her relationship to her child likely to make it impossible for her to be, unlikely for her to recidivate? So I took this language, which was very broad, I thought, and I tried to interpret it in a way which I thought was consistent with the Sentencing Reform Act. I was animated by my sense that the sentencing structure was unfair, and so there were times I could do something about it and times that I couldn't do something about it, and either way I would write an opinion about it. The answer is, we're both talking about, is you certainly start with a sense of what you think is fair. You don't pretend that you don't have that. Your experiences filter into how you see the world, and you have to acknowledge that. But we also deal in a framework, and it's a framework that you have to struggle with. It's not a framework that necessarily dictates the outcomes. It may dictate a series of outcomes. Rarely dictates a single answer. And you struggle with what you think the outcome should be.
In a situation like that, where you really do run up against the wall, either as a matter of how the law has been interpreted or how the law has been written by the political branches, the legislature or the Congress, to what extent should a judge and to what extent did you think you should write what we as litigators used to call open letters to the Court of Appeals or open letters to Congress? And to what extent should you just decide the case in front of you?
I wrote open letters to the Congress.
Yes, you did. That's why I'm.
I did.
That's why I'm goading you. And,
yeah. No, I did.
Can you
I
give
did.
Us a couple of good examples of some of your open letters to Congress?
Well, actually, there's a better example from another judge, but I certainly did this as well, where he had someone. The government brought a charge. That charge had a mandatory minimum. The mandatory minimum was the floor of the sentence. No one ever got above it, but you had to get the mandatory minimum. And Judge Gleason in the Eastern District of New York wrote a decision saying, I will sentence Mr. Vasquez, I think his name was, to the 5-year mandatory minimum. But make no mistake about it, there's no judging going on here. I have done no judging in this case. Everyone who, and then he described the man's background, which of course was inconsistent with the profile of the offender that had triggered the mandatory minimum. So he wrote about his background and he said, and in imposing this sentence, everyone in the courtroom understood how profoundly unfair it was. And I thought that that was terribly important to say. I said similar kinds of things in my writings as well, because again, I did not want to pretend that what I was doing was fair, because it wasn't. And I thought that that was a dialogue that we needed to have. And that's why I'm not on the Supreme Court.
Before Sandra Day O'Connor was appointed as the first woman on the United States Supreme Court, there was a celebrated case involving claim of gender-based discrimination and whether or not health plans that failed to cover pregnancy benefits were gender-based discrimination. And the Supreme Court of the United States held that it was not gender-based discrimination. It was not a distinction between men and women. It was a distinction between pregnant persons and non-pregnant persons. Now, the quip that went around the legal world at the time and led, among other things, to President Reagan appointing the first woman to the Supreme Court was, only 9 men in a room together could have written that. But to a certain extent, the conversation changes based on who's present in the room. It's often said that when you add one justice to the court, it doesn't just change one vote, it changes the entire conversation. If Thurgood Marshall is in the room, then there's a certain kind of conversation. You take him out of the room, it's a different conversation. So I wonder if you feel that you have, and in what ways have affected the conversation that takes place among the justices on the Israeli Supreme Court, and maybe you have, without revealing confidences that you can't, an example that you could share of where either something you said or maybe your very presence affects how a conversation took place in discussing the case.
Of the over, the change, the different views of the judges?
The judges, the and but also just the perspective that comes into the room. I mean, I think the discussion about G against Gilbert was not 9 men who were trying to do a bad thing. They were obviously, you know, thinking this way, and the very fact that that there would be a woman justice in the room opened them up in a certain way.
There's a better, even a better example than that. The Seventh Circuit had a case involving pregnant prisoners and whether they should be shackled when they're giving birth, right? And the majority held that it was not an Eighth Amendment, that it was appropriate, it wasn't a violation of the Eighth Amendment, it was appropriate to shackle a pregnant prisoner because of security concerns. And there was a dissent by a woman judge that was essentially a screed. It was, are you out of your mind? The last thing anyone mid-birth is going to do is to flee, right? And it, I mean, it was, and that was the kind of thing, and it was written exactly in this, you know, the colloquial way of describing it is, ladies and gentlemen, get real. That's what you're talking about. There, that it was. Is there a perspective that you bring to the table that changes the conversation because you're there?
You know, our system doesn't seem the same like the system in the United States. In America, the judges are two kinds, conservatives and liberals, you see. And you may guess from the beginning maybe sometimes what will be the result of the case, sometimes, not always. But in Israel, it doesn't seem the same system, because we have, for example, three religious judges, and people may think that they think the same they have the same attitude in special cases concerning religious issues. But at the same time, it's not true, because some of them sometimes they don't have the same attitude in a specific case, and we discuss the cases together before giving the rulings. And we discussed before entering to the courtroom, we discussed together the case, and after the hearings, we go back to our chambers and again discuss and we change views, all the judges together, and sometimes you try to convince the judge to change his mind. It's okay, no problem. But we don't have this, we divide the court for two conservative liberals. It depends on the case before us, and we are all open-minded for every decision which will be given in the specific case.
You're not suggesting United States Supreme Court justices aren't open-minded.
Yeah, they're open-minded.
but I think you are suggesting, yeah, and properly so, that we have a highly politicized judiciary at this point, at least by public perception, and to a certain extent by reality on the bench. Would you say that the Israeli judiciary is not a politicized judiciary?
Of course. The judiciary in Israel is independent in both material and personal. Material by they are subject, judges are subject only to the law, or no any other person or institute. And personal by the way of appointing judges in Israel. Judges in Israel are appointed by a committee of 9 members. The chairman is the Minister of Justice, and among its members, another minister from the cabinet, 2 members of the parliament, 2 members of the Israeli Bar Association, and 3 justices of the Supreme Court, including the president. You may notice that 5 out of the 4 members are not politicians. And this is, this is the right way to appoint judges, not by politicians. In our country, it works very well. And for this reason, we are independent totally, out of politics. This is the way that we appoint judges. In all levels, from the magistrate until the Supreme Court. This is the way, and we prefer not to be involved by the politicians in appointing judges.
Would the American system be better off with such a system of appointment?
I think it would, but I think our situation is more complicated. The Supreme Court selection is totally politicized. I'm persuaded that the district court that I sat on and the Court of Appeals, people are selected as judges in direct proportion to their never having said anything political in their lives. It's a very interesting situation, so that in fact, while we're talking about engaging with the issues and weighing and measuring, the principal pressure I felt at the district court level was to duck, avoid, and evade making a decision. In other words, it's politicized, and the response to the politicization is, how can I get people to plead guilty? How can I get people to settle the cases? How can I make sure that I write an opinion which says nothing except something technical? And that, the Supreme Court is very different. But I actually think it may well be that the politicization of the Supreme Court has shut down the rest of the bench, totally shut down the rest of the bench. People read about, these big cases that judges decide, gay rights, et cetera. The cases I struggled with were the cases that were not the big cases, that the cases that were dying in my court because people were just churning because every pressure was just to move the cases. Keep your head down and move the cases.
So where's that pressure coming from? You say all the pressures. Where are those pressures coming from?
I think part of it is the political context, which is you avoid being labeled an activist if essentially you never decide anything. You don't have to worry. You avoid being labeled an activist if you settle cases or people plead guilty, then you can say there's nothing I could do. They settled the case. Part of it I write about, which is sort of arcane to some degree, is the court has become very efficient. And so as Professor Koh described it at Yale Law School, he said, sometimes when you cannot measure what's important becomes what you measure. So if you can't measure what's important, which is, dare I say it, justice, you can't, dignity, you can't measure it. So therefore, we begin to make important what you can measure. And so we had to, every 6 months, you had to list the cases that were pending over, motions that were pending over 6 months, or cases that are older than 3 years. And what that meant, I'm studying this now as part of the work that I'm doing, is that the civil rights cases, police abuse cases, were dismissed on technical grounds to move the cases. The case that I described about the woman who was who had sex with a guard, right? Every pressure was to say 20 cases, dismiss this case, sure, dismissed on the strength of A, B, C, and D. Part of what I brought to the table was, wait a minute, these cases should not be churned out. So the lower federal courts, I think, are not politicized in the way that you're describing, and they have fled from that kind of politicization. The Supreme Court is an entirely different situation, and I think the courts of appeals are to some degree,
too. Do you face sometimes pressure by the public or the media?
I didn't feel pressure from the public, necessarily. I certainly felt funny kind of pressure from the media. When a civil rights lawyer or criminal defense lawyer becomes a judge, you certainly feel the pressure to act against type, much like the Civil War judges. Oh, I'll throw the book at this defendant just to prove I'm a judge, or I'll rule in this way just to prove that I'm independent. And I resisted that when I could, if I thought that that was the wrong outcome. The press would describe, I required a hearing in a case involving scientific evidence. I just required a hearing. And the Globe had an article that says, Gertner requires a hearing in cases involving scientific evidence. And essentially the next paragraph was, remember who she was. And I thought, this was preposterous. Right? I was being criticized for holding a hearing. A prosecutor doesn't get the second paragraph. If the prosecutor does anything, the paper will describe it as he did it this way or that way. But I was constantly fighting, reminding the audience of where I had come from. And then I did something which I know that other judges wouldn't do. I mean, I wrote to the Globe. And I would say this is not, that paragraph didn't have any relationship to what I did. So I felt pressure to act against type, and then I felt pressure to justify it when I wasn't acting against type.
But let me push on this just a little more, because after all, you had life tenure if you wanted to stay on. So why is there pressure? And I'm purposely being a little naive, so I understand the where the pressures are coming from. But I recall one judge in the Southern District of New York where I practiced who famously told the chief judge of the circuit, I don't recall anything in Article 3 of the Constitution of how long the printout of my cases can be. And he just decided that he would not abide by the 90-day list and the 180-day list, and his list was the longest in the court, and all the assistant U.S. attorneys knew that. And depending on the nature of your case, you either liked or didn't like that, but you knew that was who he was, and he had life tenure, that's what he was going to do. So why doesn't life tenure immunize you from all of that pressure?
It should. It certainly should, there's no question about it, but what I experienced, it was that judges were risk averse. They didn't want to be criticized in the media. They didn't want to have the article about how you had these cases pending. I mean, I was ready to, they didn't want to have the article. Judges were not supposed to respond to this kind of criticism. No one responded on your behalf.
There's no spokesman of the court who responded?
There was no spokesman for the court, no. And, and I actually, now that I'm no longer a judge, I'm happy to speak sometimes on behalf of and sometimes critical of. Someone wrote me, a Boston Globe reporter wrote me about a case that was pending before a judge on a testing issue, on a discriminatory testing issue, and how come the case was around for 8 or 9 months. And I said, not because the judge is golfing, right? It's because the issue is hard. And you can trust that that's the reason for the delay. And sometimes efficiency is not consistent with justice. But no one said that, we don't have a spokesperson. So you have canned media coverage. Now, sure, a judge should say, why should I care? Now, I cared. I cared because the job of the court was legitimacy. I wasn't in it for the money, certainly. I wasn't even in it for the status. I was in it because I thought I could accomplish something, and I wanted what I did to be to appear legitimate. There's another story, but Brian McGrory, who's now the editor of The Globe, wrote a column criticizing a decision I wrote. Totally unfairly. I mean, just criticized an horrible decision. And didn't pay any attention to the fact that I had written a formal opinion. Just criticized the opinion. So I wrote to the ombudsman of The Globe saying, you know, he has a right to his opinion, but here was a decision that I wrote, 30 or 40 pages, which he had obviously not read. And the ombudsman determined he was a columnist and not a reporter, and so he had a right to say what he said. And then after that was over, friends of his and friends of mine got in touch with each of us separately and said, you know, McGrory's really a good guy and cares deeply about issues of justice. And said to McGrory, you know, she's really quite a good judge and cares about these issues. And we became good friends. And the coverage changed as a result of that. but my point is that I cared about the press because I cared that what we did was seen as legitimate by the public.
Not just be legitimate, but appear to be
That's
legitimate.
Right.
And
That's
those
right.
are actually both very significant for the,
That's
for the
right.
court. What kinds of pressures do you feel in the Israeli Supreme Court? And now actually not as a particularly as an Arab justice on the court, but as a justice on the highest court in Israel. Are there similar pressures, different pressures?
I think the similar pressures everywhere. But there is pressure by the press. We are a very active press. They are covering the Supreme Court in all the media in Israel, TV and newspapers and internet, you know. And somebody says, how you can live in such a situation that all the press are talking about you and you say that, I don't mind. It's not true, because you read newspapers and you watch TV sometimes, but at the same time, it doesn't work. We say that they have the right, of course, the freedom of expression, but for us, we will not consider it and we will continue our work without any pressure. This is the better way to serve our community in Israel by making justice to all the people of the country without any pressure from anybody.
You should try being a university president. I tell
Please
people,
tell me when you are will be retiring so that I will give my candidate.
That's when I get my First Amendment rights back. That's right. You know, I always told people, it's not that I have a thick skin, but I'm good at pretending that I have a thick skin, and that sometimes is just as important. To what extent do the judges on the court talk about these kinds of issues? So not about what the law is per se, but the very very question of judging and judging in the face of these kinds of pressures, because many of the issues that your court takes up are ones that necessarily have implications for national security. Which means they're not only national issues, but actually have international ramifications.
Well, of course, we discuss those matters between us as judges every day. And we have a lot of cases concerning national security, and we are trying to do all our best in order to settle those cases very quickly and without any pressure. But we discuss every day those very important cases between other judges.
And to what extent, and now I think we're going to have a difference in American and Israeli law here that I want to explore a little bit. What's the limit of the court's authority on issues of national security? For example, the famous case involving the legitimacy of and the location of the separation fence. There was an argument, and one might argue that an American court would say it's what we would call a non-justiciable issue. That is for the political branches, for the executive branches, checked by in our system, the executive branches checked by Congress to make those decisions, and the court is not really in a position to do that. Whereas in Israel, the court waded in quite fact-intensive way, actually talking about where the fence ought to go. Why does the court have the authority to do that?
Because the court should give justice to all the parts of the population in the country and outside the country, including Palestinian petitioners who comes to the Israeli Supreme Court to sue the Israeli government in your example on the separation wall, there were about 80 cases, 80 petitions filed by Palestinians against this wall. And in more than one case, the Supreme Court decided to accept some of those petitions and decided to change the route of the separation wall in some places in order to minimize damages caused to the Palestinian property. I think it's good. I can't say that all the petitions filed against the separation wall was accepted, but some of them were accepted, and I think it is good.
The people here sitting here, I think, are interested in how judges make judgments. What you're talking about is the situation judges find themselves in. Judge Gertner, you sound more like a victim of the system, which is the same thing that you often, the same people you often protected. So I'm more interested in how judges judge than the dilemmas that judges find themselves in. And so I think me and maybe some other people get more value out of the discussion. I think this would be a relevant topic if you were sitting talking to a group of judges, but we're not. We're just ordinary human beings.
I didn't feel myself a victim. I did what I thought was right, given the framework that I had,
and then railed about the framework. So how do judges, it's hard to describe how you judge out of the context of a particular case, but let me give you one case. About 4 or 5 years before I left the bench, I got a desegregation case, an affirmative action case. This is before the Supreme Court, the recent Supreme Court rulings essentially narrowing the space for affirmative action in desegregating schools. There's a case involving the Lynn Public Schools, which had an extraordinarily good program of, for want of a better word, racial mixing, really. It's a combination of things. The Supreme Court had actually not yet ruled on this issue, but I understood where the Supreme Court was going. It was not a direction that I would have wanted to go in. I understood that the constitutional issues were changing dramatically. And I said to the parties that every premise in Brown versus Board of Education, the desegregation decision, was now up for grabs, now had to be litigated, was now contested. Was there a justification for desegregation? We no longer could simply state it. You had to prove it, and you had to prove it in the context of this school. And I said I was going to hold a hearing on all of the issues, and nothing would be taken for granted any longer. I wanted to take things for granted. I had been raised in the post-Brown versus Board of Education era, but I knew that the law was changing. So my judging involved holding a hearing, having people talk about educational policy, talk about the significance of situations overwhelmingly black schools. And I wrote another 60 or 70 page decision in which I supported the Lynn desegregation effort. I would not have done that if the evidence had not been there. And I'm not sure that I would have called for that kind of elaborate evidence, but I understood the framework that we were dealing with. So who I was made me understand where the law had been and where it was going. Understood that this was something that had to be litigated. I was listening to the litigation as fairly as I could, to the evidence as fairly as I could, and then I wrote a decision affirming the plan, which was then ultimately, by the way, affirmed by the Supreme Court. It's not clear where that stands now, many years later, but in any event. So I didn't approach the issue as a, as they say, as a tabula rasa. I didn't approach the issue as a blank slate. I had certain opinions. I had been a litigator during this period of time, but I understood what the law required, and I understood what I had to do as a judge. It's hard to talk about judging out of the context of a particular case, but that's as close as I can get.
Next question. While we're getting the next question, I wanted to ask a question to you, which is, Maybe you could tell us a little bit about how many cases you hear and what kind of pressures that puts on each of you.
Not too many cases. If we compare the cases filed to our court with the Federal Supreme Court in Washington, D.C., where in Washington, D.C., there are about between 80 and 90 cases every year, we have this number every day. Then you can make, you can calculate it. We have about 4,000 cases every year. And we sit in a panel of three judges usually. And we have four panels every day, and every panel has about 15 or 17 cases. Then this is the number of cases in our court, and we're working very hard. It's because we do not have a court of appeal between the district court and the Supreme Court. We have about 3,000 cases, appeal cases, both criminal and civil cases. And at the same time, the second function of the Supreme Court is hearing petitions filed by citizens of the country who are claiming violation of human rights by one of the branches of the government while operating in the public arena. They have the right to apply directly to the Supreme Court without going first to the lower courts. And we have about 1,000 cases from this kind of cases. It's a huge number, but we are surviving.
So in that context, you sit as a court of first instance. You were
essentially
a trial court.
Yes, it's the first and last instance. I think it's the only place in the world that such jurisdiction exists.
Right.
But at the same time, we don't have a problem with that. We want to give the feeling to every citizen of the country that somebody is listening for him. And he may apply alone without assistance of an attorney. He may write his petition in his handwriting, and he pays the fees, and sometimes even he has the chance to appear before a panel of three judges and argue his case. And even he lost his case, he goes back to his city and tell his friends, you know, today I have appeared before a panel of three judges of the Supreme Court, and this was very, very interesting to me. And for us, it is good feeling give to that citizen somebody listen to him. Maybe he didn't won his case, but this is a good feeling that everybody is sure that he is protected and by the Supreme Court.
And we are just the opposite. We are just the opposite. We have created in civil rights law and discrimination law a series of tripwires. Technical requirements that result in cases being dismissed without their ever getting to the merits, and that's completely a function of what the courts have done. Some of it is Congress to some degree, but a great deal of it is what the courts have done. Again, to make it concrete, I had a little case of a very important to the guy. His hand was injured by a saw in an accident. He goes before a jury, he gets an award. I wasn't the judge. Goes up to the Court of Appeals, the Court of Appeals reverses the award. At that point, the man died, and his estate would continue the case, and I got the case. The lawyer made a mistake. The lawyer forgot to file the papers that would substitute the estate for the man and missed the deadline. It was a March time. It was in March, and I was supposed to look through, you know, I had to report how many pending cases I had. I had a wonderful clerk who sat down and said, well, let's go through the list, Judge. This case, the case of the man with the saw, you know, you could dismiss the case. The lawyer failed to file the piece of paper in time. And then he looked up at me and he said, but justice in the world suggests you let the case go forward. I let the case go forward. But those are the kind. That's what I was talking about choice at my level, inherent in everything. What you put on at the beginning of your day, at the end of the day, how you interpreted these requirements. But it also suggests what a series of stupid technical tripwires we have raised to important issues so that people avoid making a decision. Now, again, the Supreme Court is different because the Supreme Court has to engage with issues, but at the level of the district court, the level of the Court of Appeals, too often people are dismissed out of court on hyper-technical, empty decisions.
But what I have really also an example for a little case, but it's not all the cases like that. We have very serious cases. One petitioner applied to the court, ordering the Minister of Interior, after his death, to throw his body to the sea. Why? Because during his life he used to eat fish, and now he wants the fish to eat his body. And he applied to the Supreme Court. He says, this is one example, you know. But we have much more serious cases than this one.
Well, I certainly can't beat that.
Yeah, no, dare I say, that sounds a little fishy to me.
Hi. I'm not sure what happens in Israel, but in this country, and I would be happy to have my opinion changed, my sense of the tenure of a judge in this country and the ability to actually have a judge not become a judge because of the people. In other words, there's no set limit of term limits for judges. And I find that to be very concerning, and I think it's a powerful position that can be definitely abused. And I wondered about your thoughts about this kind of issue, because you can have someone being a judge for years, and they can do whatever they want, and there aren't that many people who would be able to remove them from being a judge. So I just wondered if you had some thoughts on that, Judge.
If I could turn the question one small piece, because sure. There's an easy answer, which is not the good answer to your question. There's an easy answer as a matter of why they're on for so long. The Constitution does give them life tenure. So the question really is, would we be better off with a provision that provides 10-year terms or 20-year terms rather than life tenure?
So you're saying the Constitution does allow that to be a tenured position? That's what you were just saying.
It creates life tenure. The same Charles Black I referred to earlier used to say that there is very little in the Constitution that could not have been done by Congress as a political matter or as a practical matter. And he said it was a very short list of things that you had to have the Constitution for, and life tenure for judges was one of them. He said that Congress would never have done that on its own.
The notion of life tenure and the notion of that you can't reduce a judge's salary were so to create institutional supports for independence from the political branches. That was the purpose of it. As I said, my experience of judges was that independence can't be conveyed by those institutions. There were judges that didn't feel independent, even though they had life tenure, felt pressure from this, pressure from reporting requirements, felt pressure from the press. So I actually did not see, quote, judges doing whatever they wanted to do. I saw judges, federal judges for the most part, ducking, avoiding responsibility, not making decisions so that they wouldn't be criticized. It's ironic, you know, you're putting together a portrait of activist judges who are on the bench forever and doing whatever the hell they want to do. I really didn't see that. The process of judicial selection, perhaps, created a bench, an American bench, that is so much more timid than judges in other countries. You read about the cases where a judge has not been timid, but the run-of-the-mill, everyday case, the judges are being risk-averse when they don't have to be. So I don't see the problem that you're describing. In addition, by the way, we have numbers of state court judges, not in the Massachusetts, who are elected. And that creates issues which are very, very, very troubling.
What you just said, actually, because you said that they would be more timid, wouldn't that also be a reason why there should be term offices? Because then they won't be allowed to stay in that position making judgments that aren't really necessarily appropriate decisions.
Well, that would be so, except that we continue, because a federal judge has to be confirmed by the Senate, because the Senate is so politicized, the only people who get through that process are usually people who, well, not necessarily agree, because the process is divided. I mean, in other words, the Congress is divided. So it's usually people who get through it who haven't said anything in their life, people who are not, about whom you know next to nothing, because if you knew something about them, they are likely not to make it through. I was an exception. Ted Kennedy was remarkable and was determined that I be a judge and used his political capital to get me through. Someone like me wouldn't even be proposed today. Now, you may think that's a good thing, you may think that's a bad thing, but essentially, the people who get through are people who can make it through the gauntlet of the Senate. And they tend to be people who you don't know very much about.
So I just wanted to turn to Justice Joubran, because you will be retiring in 3 years. A mandatory retirement age is 70. What's your thought about that? Is that a good thing or a bad thing?
Which?
That you're retiring. The mandatory retirement.
Yes, I think it's the very good to retire at the age of 70. First of all, in order to bring new blood to the court, it's more healthy. And then I will have time for my family, for my grandchildren, and to tour all over the world, and to come to visit cities, nice cities like Boston, and to meet very good friends here. And before concluding, I want to tell you a short story going back to my background and my relations between me and the Jewish people. The story says that when I was a young student at the Hebrew University in 1964, it is 51 years back, my first roommate at the university was a Jewish student from Brookline named Robert Hausman, and he is with us here. Where is Bob? Oh, yeah.
Oh, my.
And we are still good friends until now. While I was appointed to the Supreme Court, I received a greeting letter from him, and I called him back, and he came to visit me last year in Jerusalem, and it was a great surprise for me to meet him yesterday and today. Thank you, Robert.
That's wonderful.
But, so but then I'm we can gonna... ask you, was he always like this?
A wonderful person. No. Wonderful roommate. Some of my, there were 74 of us at Hebrew University. Some of them had problems with their Jewish roommates, but I had a great roommate.
Yeah, but we heard what your mother said. Maybe Justice Joubran can tell us what your mother said. Why don't you tell that?
His mother didn't know me and my family, but she said, I sent my son to Eretz Israel to live with an Arab student, you know.
And okay.
Papa said, no, it's okay, he is a good man, he's a family, good family, you know.
This question is for Nancy Gertner. Do you feel that the United States government, the Department of Justice, takes advantage of the criminal defendants because of their charging the most serious crimes they can in each case, not taking into account the defendant, and having all kinds of assets to prosecute the case where the defendants don't have that asset?
Yes. The model of the criminal justice system are two equal parties with the judges and referee. After 20 years of mandatory punishments on the federal side, the playing field is not remotely equal. The government has weapons that are just out of proportion to anything that the defense has. And one of the things I'm trying to write about, I felt very much as a judge, how can you be a judge in a situation which is so unequal? It felt very much like the title to Howard Zinn's book, You Can't Be Neutral on a Moving Train. What are the judge's obligations in a situation where things are so out of balance? Everyone in this room is familiar with the Aaron Schwartz case. Schwartz was an internet genius who violated the law. The government brings charges against him, which carried, I don't remember, it was something like 20-year potential punishment. I don't remember exactly what it was. If he went to trial and was convicted, the guidelines would kick in and he would get this kind of extraordinary sentence that created a disincentive for him to bring a constitutional challenge to the prosecution, which was entirely fair. But why would you run that risk when in the balance is 20 years? And in the middle, the government then offered him a plea of guilty to 6 months. If 6 months was an appropriate sentence on a plea, why wasn't an appropriate sentence after trial?
Well, the issue was that the government had the resources and the power to skew the bargain. And that's something which we have to change as a society. That's partly legislative, it's partly prosecutorial discretion, but mostly it's the structure of punishment. So yes.
to the extent you can, the question about the role of the new Minister of Justice and how she might affect the court and the relationship between the government and the court.
My response is like that. If you will invite me after the 4th of August 2017, I will be able to respond to this question.
And Mr. Justice, we shall be waiting.
That's one of the great non-responses of our time.
Hi, thank you all for a fascinating conversation. Judge Gertner, I wanted to ask you to take this to the personal where it might be relevant for us. You were on NPR talking about the death penalty, and I was wondering what you thought jurors should do if they're against the death penalty, but they would be not put on a jury to make a decision in a death penalty case. Does that bias our ability to mete out justice? How do we resolve that?
Well, you have to be honest. If you got selected for a jury that was dealing with death, and you don't think you could impose the death penalty, you have to be honest about it. I can't be urging people to be dishonest to get on a jury and then sort of scuttle the decision. What I wrote in the Globe over the weekend after the Tsarnaev verdict is that death qualification is part and parcel of a death penalty system, meaning you have to have jurors who are willing to, who will say that they are willing to impose death if the case requires it, in the same way that you have to have jurors who believe that they could impose, that they could convict on the drug laws. You wouldn't ever select a juror that said, I'm sorry, I don't believe in the drug penalties, I would never convict. So that question is to some degree part of the system. We surely, after the Tsarnaev verdict, can step back and say, what is wrong with this system? That's a different question than the death qualification question. As I wrote, you know, in a certain sense, I was death qualified as a judge. There are three questions asked of me at my confirmation. One question was, could you impose the death penalty if you had to? Now, this is another example of the difference between our opinions, our personal feelings, and what the job required. I thought a long time before I applied for a judgeship. I was unalterably opposed to the death penalty, but I understood that the time could come that I would have been in the same position as Judge O'Toole, and if a jury determined death, I would have to impose it. My solution to that, if it's a solution at all, I got a death penalty case during the course of my judgeship, was to make sure that the trial was as fair as I could humanly make it. And that would be my role, was to make this as fair a process as I could. But I had to acknowledge that if I made a perfectly fair trial and the verdict came out for death, I would have to impose the death penalty. I couldn't have taken the job unless I was prepared to say that. So the issue is structural, not this particular case, not what an individual juror should do. The issue is the system that enabled the death penalty and the things that flow from it. And that's what we should be talking about.
Right, Jeffrey, we have time. With your permission, I want to go back for a while for the question of the Minister of Justice. Although I decided not to refer because it's an internal matter in Israel. But at the same time, I can say that our Chief Justice greeted the Minister of Justice, and we hope that there will be full cooperation between the minister and the court for the benefit of all the people of the state of Israel, and we hope so.
This is for Justice Joubran. First of all, welcome to Boston. You know Boston is Haifa's sister city. We're very pleased to have you here. But my question to you is, there was a recent Israeli law that's quite controversial that limits the rights of Israeli citizens to ask for boycott or divestment or sanctions against Israeli businesses. And I don't know how you ruled on it. I know it's a very complex decision that is many pages and has many sections to it, but if you could share with us how you ruled on that the court's decision that essentially upholds most of that law and how that impacts freedom of expression for Israelis.
Well, again, I should say that I cannot comment on rulings given by myself or by my colleagues at the court. In Israel, there is saying that judges say their opinions in their rulings, and that's all. And the rest is for the academia and for the public and for the media. I can't respond. I gave my opinion as it was in the ruling, and that's all.
Well, we can. You can read the ruling.
You can read it. You know, in the Cardozo University, there is a project of translating most of our judgments to English. Then you will have the chance to read more and more about the rulings of the Supreme Court, which many of them are very interesting.
And on that note, I can assure you one thing, it was well written. Whatever he said was well written. I want to thank Judge Gertner, President Lawrence, and Justice Joubran.
Thank you.
Sometimes the demonstration will be 100, sometimes 3,000. The important that we continue our demonstrations.